Good evening to all. Today we are going to have an important topic about the emerging risks of small ruminants and the neonatal diseases. As I told, the small ruminant practice or small ruminant animal husbandry practice is coming up, so especially it is getting important nowadays because of the demand for meat. So even some of the people who left IT job also, they are very much interested to solve this small ruminants project. So since it is having very much opportunity to have a better marketing systems, especially in semi-urban areas. So even though the people are very much interested in small ruminant animal husbandry practices, but sometimes some people used to give misinformation about this project. So whoever fails because of their mismanagement, so people used to get some misguiding information from the people. But so when we do the proper management system, when we execute the proper management system in small animal husbandry practices, definitely we can able to earn so much money since the small ruminant practice is being considered as mobile ATM for poor people. So especially if you see the animal husbandry practices, amongst animal husbandry practices, the small ruminants are gaining much importance nowadays in rural village economy rather than this dairy sector. Sometimes the dairy sector is to fail because of the competition among the practitioners. That means the buyers, so they used to get the milk at the lowest rate, then when they go for their own marketing, they used to sell high cost. So, but slowly the people are moving towards these small ruminant practices since the meat cost is going up at a steady state constant manner. So, before going to this actual topics, first we should know, since we are going to discuss about the infectious diseases, we should know what is infection. So I will be going a little fast since I have to cover a lot of slides. So infection means it is the presence or multiplication of microorganisms in the tissues of host, which may or may not have the signs or symptoms. So the pathogen may be entering into the host, where it may undergo the multiplications. So based on its characteristics, the host as well as the pathogen characteristics, environmental characteristics, it used to yield sometimes the obvious clinical signs or overt clinical signs, or sometimes may not be. So that time will be called as infection. Whereas normal flora, it is normally considered as a bacteria that are frequently found in everyone in specific parts of the body. So then colonization. So colonization means presence of bacteria without multiplication and damage to the host tissue. So this is what you should know when we discuss about the infectious diseases. Generally, see this infectious disease cycle. So it all depends on certain or epidemiological triad patterns, or ways the transmission dynamics or the link or chain. So of different factors. So it needs to have the susceptible host, then the causative agent. So for which the causative agent, when you expect the pathogen to be present in the environment, definitely needs to have the infected animals or the reservoirs. Then portal of exit. So the animal, once the pathogen enters the body, then obviously it has to come out from either through feces or excretions. Then mode of transmission. There are so many mode of transmission for pathogens. We will discuss later. Then portal of entry. So how it enters the body into the susceptible host. Or then thereafter we are going to study about the species tropism. Here, the species tropism may be considering the small ruminants, since we are going to cover the topic on only small ruminants. So this dynamics, if you see this, so the pathogens, so they mainly depends upon the portal of entry. There is susceptible host, it needs to have the susceptible host. And causal agent, obviously without causal agent, there is no infectious disease. Then when you want to have a pathogen in the environmental system or environmental niche, it needs definitely it needs to have the reservoir for their presence. Then portal of exit, mode of transmission. Mainly see these pathogen characteristics. So the pathogens, the other way is the capability to induce the disease or the view of getting the overt clinical signs. If the pathogen has to complain four parameters, four characteristics you should be try. The first one is infectivity. So that means infected dose. How much of pathogen is really required in this disease? So the pathogen requirement will be varying from disease to disease in view of inducing the disease. For example, if you take the example of salmonellosis, the individual has to consume about 10 power 5 to 10 power 7 microorganisms in view of individual disease. Whereas when you consider this Coxiella burridae, even less than 5-10 organisms are the most sufficient to induce the disease. So the plots, the infective dose determines the infectivity. Then pathogenicity, the ability to induce the disease, the virulence, then invasiveness. These three parameters, these three as well as the infectivity, determines the characteristics of the pathogen in view of inducing the disease. So when you see the host factors, the one is host specificity. So every pathogen needs to have its own specificity, then viability, so then endogenic variation and resistance. These are certain other parameters. So when we discuss about these emerging diseases, so emerging is as we have discussed in the last webinar. So the infectious diseases usually they used to have a shape course of human history. So from since human civilization started, so we that time they used to know about the disease, but they don't know which organisms would be causing the disease. But when the civilization has started improving, then we are able to come out of the important aspects, especially after 18th, 19th century. But there is every indication that the disease will continue to be civilian and global events. So these infectious diseases are continuously going to pose a threat to the animals as well as human population. That's the reason. So because of the human population dynamics and other parameters, our greediness nature of the human beings, so we used to do the deforestation, thereby we used to succumb to this emerging diseases from the sylvatic site. So then when you see these forces, there are number of driving forces in societal changes. Not only driving forces, but also the societal changes are now creating an unprecedented environment that favors the expansion as well as the alteration of group of the disease, termed emerging or re-emerging disease, as well as zoonosis. So the microbes continue to evolve and adapt. So the microbes also continuously evolving itself and get it adapted in several species. They will try to adapt it in different species. However, the tremendous acceleration expansion of the global trade because of the introduction of the WTO since 1985, since the introduction of the WTO World Trade Organization. So nowadays the animal husbandry trade is made convenient. So from one continent to other continent, it is being export and import is being very common. So because of the global trade, then human movements and travel and burgeoning global population of people as well as animals. So these emerging diseases are continuously threatening the human as well as animal population. So the microbes have an even greater opportunity to adapt because of this quasi species dynamics and spillover, spillback. All these mechanisms also responsible for microbes to get it adapted in different species tropism and change in their characteristics. So they are also being transported new host and ecosystem out of the catastrophe. Sometimes this may end up with catastrophism as we used to experience in the COVID-19. So as of now. So then changes in the weather meteorology factors, especially the weather, climatic conditions and ecosystems. So whenever there is a breach in ecosystem, especially in the ecological mosaic or interface, so otherwise in the sylvatic cycles, then pathogen exists in the sylvatic cycles to that means the escape from those from their niche and then enters into these domestic plain areas where we get it adopted and animal species thereby produces some emerging diseases. An animal production system, so like the integrated farming system and economic development and the land use, all these factors are continue to alter the dynamic between the epidemiological triad. Otherwise, you can say is the agent, host, and environment. So apart from that, the vectors, even this management practices, whenever there is a breach in the biosecurity practices or the management practices, obviously, so these emerging diseases are coming up. So then the emerging disease, generally when you define emerging diseases, it is a new infection resulting from the evolution. It may be from the new one, otherwise evolution or change of an existing pathogen or parasite resulting in the change of hostage. Suppose if it is a new one, that can be sometimes it will be considered as evolution. Otherwise, when there is a change of an existing pathogen or parasite, so because of this mutation or recombination or any other genetic changes. So then where it will be trying to change your host system, or it will be expanding their host system, or otherwise it may be transferred to the vectors. And by then, whenever there is a change in the pathogenicity pattern and strain variations, all these factors are responsible for emergence of these emerging diseases. So otherwise, you can say the known agents occur in a new geographical area. So then whenever the agent is considered to be appeared in the new geographical area, that time there it will be considered as emerging. Otherwise, a known disease that has recently increased. So suppose if the increase may be in 0.51% level, suddenly the incidence is going up about 10%, 15%, something like that. That time also it will be considered as emerging diseases. A known agent or a close relative occurring in new species, that time also it will be of emerging disease, or previously unknown agent detected for the first time. So that is also being considered as the emerging diseases. So factors responsible for PCR, there are, it can be classified into four categories: the pathogen characteristics, host characteristics, environmental changes, then progress in science and technology. So these things, I think for last webinar we have discussed, same thing is going to be here also. So the pathogen characteristics mainly because of the evolution or selection pressure, or the constant mutation as it happens in the RNA viruses due to quasi-species dynamics nature, or then immune pressure. So these parameters actually is to determine the pathogen characteristics apart from its virulence, sensitivity, pathogenicity, and invasiveness. Then when you see the host characteristics, it's purely based on the native population. The population is devoid of any immunological pressure or against the pathogens, or when there is no related pathogen, or when there is no antigen related pathogen where it can able to offer cross protection. If it is not so, then obviously they may be considered as a population which are susceptible for any new pathogens. Then immune suppression. So when there is a general immune suppression because of the immunodeficiency viruses or retroviruses, that time they are being considered as susceptible. So then increase in host population. So these factors are responsible for host characteristics of susceptible nature. This is the environmental changes. Mainly nowadays, the environmental changes are playing major role in coming up with the emerging diseases. So because of the climatic changes, so the global warming effect or the El Nino, La Nina effect, so in, through the facility of sea, then increased rainfall or catastrophic rainfall or flood, all the situation and natural calamities, these are the some of the climatic changes whereby it paves way for the emergence of new diseases. Then vector characteristics. So because of the human breach in the ecosystems, especially in the forest area or sylvatic cycles, so in view of expanding their agricultural systems, if either government or otherwise the people or industry, if they go and occupy those places, then obviously they have to do the deforestation. In such circumstances, so the vector which is present, which is being considered as a niche for in that system, is getting expanded to the plain areas whereby it transmits some of the new pathogens to the susceptible species. Then migrations, especially the vector characteristics is the migrations, increase in vector population, then vector range, vector competence, and change in vector behavior. These are some of the vector behavior whereby it produces or transmits the pathogens to the susceptible animals. So then next important thing is the overpopulation, of course. When the population is high, so suppose there is a densely populated, then obviously the transmission dynamics will become very easier. That may be pathogen is getting transmitted very easily to other from infector to other live population. Then intensive animal agriculture practices. When you go for intensive or integrated animal agriculture practices, that time also the causes with that means the transmission transition possibilities are there. Then increased backward animal production. Then yes, the sylvatic cycles, especially the interspecies transmission of pathogens. Then environmental degradation, climate change, then globalization. These are the, in general, factors which are being considered as important for emergence of diseases. So when you see the fact, the increased importance of emerging as well as re-emerging diseases, it has stimulated the establishment of a field called systematic epidemiology. Nowadays, previously we used to deal with the soul of the epidemiology, field epidemiology. But nowadays, the new area that is systematic epidemiology is coming up, which usually focuses on the ecological as well as social factors that influence the development of these diseases. So the systematic epidemiology is playing major role nowadays, along with sentinel, otherwise the serologic surveillance system, syndromic surveillance, system. So the infectious agents which cause the emerging as well as the transformed animal diseases are already present in the environment, but get the opportunity to cause the disease under certain altered circumstances. The main source of maintenance and transmission of infectious agents, nature, if you see, it is generally determined by the zoonotic pool as well as the spillover and spillback mechanisms. The present day world, if you see, so the higher quantitative level of animal origin foods as well as the foster trade, the new trade routes as well as air travel have led to the higher risk for contracting pre-infectious as well as the diseases. So now we will move on to the disease per se about the small ruminants emerging diseases. So there are five, six emerging diseases being considered by Government of India as emerging diseases in small ruminants. The most important thing is caprine arthritis and encephalitis. So this is a major emerging disease being considered as of now in India, but rarely reported. So the caprine arthritis and encephalitis, so it is enveloped as a single stranded RNA virus. So coming under the subfamily of lentivirinae, the virus is, it can able to remain latent or undergo sporadic bouts of productive viral replications. So the virus is having the capability to become latent, and it may also undergo the sporadic bouts of productive viral replications. That's the reason there is a chance to spread the disease from the latent infected animals to other neighbor population. Then it is closely related to the ovine lentiviruses, as well as the recombination events have also been reported. The most common presentation, if you see, it is generally occurs in adult animals, it is caused arthritis. This is insidious in onset and slowly progressive. So mainly it causes arthritis in case of adult animals. So where you are able to see the swelling of affected joints, particularly in the corpus regions, but the degree of lameness may be variable. So mostly we are able to encounter this swelling of corpus joints in case of caprine arthritis. When affected animals, usually they gradually lose the weight, then you would be able to see the reduced milk production because of the chronic mastitis. Then rapidly progressing neurologic disease, it is being considered, since it causes encephalitis, it also causes rapidly progressing neurologic disease, which affects kids up to 4 months of age. So in lambs, up to 4 months of age, it occurs, it manifests as a posterior paresis progressing to quadriplegia. So it starts from posterior paresis, then progresses to the quadriplegia. So this virus usually it affects the arthritis as well as causes the encephalitis. When you see the clinical disease, maybe evident, so in a frog system, if you see, they, it could be observed maybe maximum to 10% initially goes at any given point of time. So, but it produces 4 clinical symptoms. So this disease, you would be able to see based on the clinical signs. So this disease appears in 4 forms. So one is mainly the encephalomyelitis forms, another one is arthritis. So these two are commonly noticed in all animals, all infected. That's the reason these two give the name as caprine arthritis and encephalitis. But apart from that, this virus also causes interstitial pneumonia as well as induced mastitis. So the pattern of disease usually varies with age. So from based on the infected age group, so it may be varying. So arthritis, if you see the arthritis condition, generally seen in sexually mature goats. The arthritis could be observed mostly, or 99% you will be able to see this condition only in sexually mature goats. Whereas the encephalomyelitis, if you see, is generally seen in kids 2 to 4 months old. The encephalitis form is more commonly observed in young animals and kids, whereas this arthritis is commonly observed in sexually mature goats. Then interstitial pneumonia as well as the induced mastitis are more commonly observed only in adult goats. So when you see these, some affected animals, they suffer from a wasting disorder, so characterized by poor body condition. That means body condition scoring may be very poor, rough care codes instead of this good BCS systems, you would be able to see only rough care codes in case of the affected animals. The central nervous system disease then generally progresses to lichen encephalomyelitis associated with ascending paralysis. That's the reason it is to start from the posterior paralysis to the quadriplegia. Then affected goats also show the progressive wasting as well as trembling. And the hair coat will be dull. They remain affable, alert. Still, animal will be alert, but usually maintain good appetite and sight. So, animal maintaining its own architect in a good manner as well as site, everything will be normal, but still it will be with the wasting, this will be noticed, and trembling and haircut will be done. Terminally, you see, as the condition progresses, then you will be able to see the paralysis, the deviation of head and neck, and pedaling movement. So this will be the terminal stage. Just imminent to death, you will be able to notice these kind of symptoms. The onset of arthritis, if you see, it is usually insidious. So then progresses slowly over months to years, but in some cases, you can see the disease may appear suddenly, remain static. Here the joints are swollen and painful. If you touch the swollen joints, it will be of painful, particularly corporeal joints, but also hip, stifle, shoulder, peg leg, and vertebral joints. So apart from corporeal, so though the disease, the condition is being commonly noticed in corporeal joints, so this condition can also be noticed in other joints like hip, stifle, shoulder, peg leg, and vertebral joints. Then cold weather, generally the cold weather or this chilly weather, so exacerbate the signs. That means, so the child or the cold weather will aggravate the clinical signs. Then bursae, particularly the atlanto-occipital as well as the tendon sheath or thickened. It will be thickened and distended with fluids in bursae. And thickening of joint capsules results in restricted movement. Once the joint capsules are thickened, obviously, and it will be restricting its movement, then flexion contraction will be noticed. So you will be able to see the conditions. Right side, the arthritis conditions. Left side, the paresis, posterior paresis. So slowly progressing towards the quadriplegia conditions. So these are all the typical signs noticed in affected goats. See. So when you go for diagnosis, the presumptive diagnosis is made on the basis of history. So by pathognomonic clinical signs, if you see, you will be able to suspect for caprine arthritis and encephalitis, and the clinical signs such as one or more of the syndromes. Then best is the ELISA. So ELISA are better for detecting disease in an individual animal because the sensitivity of this test is higher than that of AGAB, whereas AGAB is better considered for herd screening that against high specificity. So for herd screening practices, you can depend on AGAD, abnormal immunodeficient, the immunodeficient technique. So whereas for detection, so better to rely on ELISA technique. So PCR testing has a high specificity as well as sensitivity. It can detect infection within a day of exposure. So when you don't have the facility to go for molecular diagnosis, then better to depend on this AGAD in case of screening as a screening test, and ELISA as a diagnostic test. Treatment, so as of now, there is no specific treatment available for any of the syndromes, but the chemotherapeutic currently used for acute immunodeficiency syndrome may be useful, like zidovudine, interferon, and interleukin, and antivirals, but this may not be cost effective. But if you want to save some of the bleeding animals, that time it may be considered. Otherwise, it may not be much cost effective. Then young goats suffering from encephalomyelitis, they benefit from physical therapy if they are recommended. And water feeding may help maintain hydration as well as calorie intake. Just you have to offer the glucose as well as the hydration with fluid therapy. And antibiotics, it may be beneficial for goats affected with industrial pneumonia, especially the ambiclox or enrofloxacin or the third, fourth generation of cefoclor. Otherwise, if you would able to offer, then even go for disease cycling kind of antibiotics. So, which may be useful if you want to arrest the interstitial pneumonia as well as mastitis. Generally speaking, the prognosis is poor for encephalitic form and guarded for other forms. Control and prevention, if you see, test and segregation programs. So, in foreign countries, usually they may go for test and slaughter, but countries like India just we have to differ on segregation isolations. Infected frogs should be tested regularly. So, as by using AGAD, you can go for regular screening every 6 months once, and seropositive animals should be culled. The newborn kids should be prevented from ingesting colostrum from infected goats and should instead be fed pasteurized goat's milk or milk from CAV negative goats. All goats in the herd should undergo serological testing twice in every 6 months. Once, you should make the herd to be screened against the disease. So since the disease be, I mean, in prevalent countries, in this disease, when the disease is considered as prevalent, so those countries used to follow this system. The zero positive goat should be segregated and culled to prevent the direct contact between infected and uninfected animals. When no zero positive animal remain after two successive testing periods, suppose in any system, especially in human disease, what we used to do. So when there is no cases reported, there is continuous, there is in three succeeding years, then only the country is eligible for declaring as eradicated the disease. So the same way here, when no zero positive animals remain after two successive testing, at least for a year period, then it can consider us to be free from CAE. An effective vaccine is so far not available. The next important disease is border disease of sheep. So the border disease is caused by pestivirus family Flaviviridae, which also includes two types of bovine viral diarrhea and the class of viruses. This virus is and is related to BVD as well as hog cholera. So it is caused by infection of fetus with the non-cytopathic pestivirus. So it rarely causes, actually it would have studied in BVDMD as a cytopathy, a non-cytopathic virus. Here the border disease of sheep is caused by non-cytopathic pestivirus. Rarely causes disease in adults and is most important as a cause of an in vitro infection of lambs. And so when the kid or doe is pregnant, then the disease is more commonly observed. The condition gets its name from the fact that it was first reported in sheep along the Wales border of the United Kingdom. That's the reasons the disease has got its name as a border disease of sheep. Other names such as hairy shaker disease or fussy lamb disease also refer to some of the clinical signs seen in affected newborns. When you see the epidemiology, this isolate from sheep can infect other domestic ruminants also and pigs. So this border disease virus can also infect the other domestic ruminants and pigs. Moreover, the pestivirus isolates from a number of domestic species can infect. Again, in turn, it infects pregnant sheep, causing border disease in the offspring also. Persistently infected animals shed the virus continuously in excretion as well as their secretions, as happened in case of BVDMD. Then persistent infected ewes, they give birth to the persistent infected lambs. So that means genetically, vertical transmission is happening. Then acute infections in susceptible sheep are transient. Generally, the acute infection in susceptible sheep is transient, temporary, and results in immunity to challenge with homologous strain of BD. Whereas the infected ram shed the virus in semen as well as they infect and thereby infect other susceptible ewes. In addition to sheep and sheep contact, the transmission can also occur through contaminated needles during flock vaccination, especially iatrogenic transmission. So when you use the same needle for vaccinating all the stock, so suppose when you have a chance to have a prick in infected animals, then obviously there is a possibility of transmitting pathogen from infector to other live population by your practice, otherwise the treatment practice, otherwise through your needle and syringes.
Speaker,
the
sir.
Other ruminant species, so they are also getting the
Speaker, sir. Just sorry to interfere. Your voice is very low, sir. Can you please? Okay. Participants are requesting for.
Okay. Other ruminant species also shedding the pestivirus are a potential source of infection for sheep. So when you see this clinical signs, increase in number of abortion and weak neonatal lambs, so you can expect the abortion as well as weak neonatal lambs in case of this border disease. Then the body condition scoring, so the altered body conformation. Then changes in the fleece quality, the hair quality will be deteriorated. Then tremors, then hairs projecting above the wool, particularly along the neck and back region. So then it imports a halo effect that is most noticeable in fine-coated breeds. So this it affects the fleece quality as well as the body conformation. Then affected lambs, they are often small and their survival rate is always poor. So that means lambs, because they affected the dose is to show abortion as well as it produces weak neonatal lambs. So that is the reasons the survival rate will be always, most of the times it will be very poor. The survival rate is influenced not only by the severity of the neurological dysfunction, but also by the standard of animal care. So apart from neurological dysfunction, it also depends on the managemental care. In wellness lambs, you can see the neurological signs gradually abate, and such animals may eventually become clinically normal. So diagnosis, so mostly based on the pathognomonic clinical signs. Most of the times we could be able to find based on the experience. So otherwise you have to depend on the laboratory diagnostic test. So otherwise you have to develop the technique of doing differential diagnosis. So when you develop our differential diagnosis habit in a better way, where you could be able to pinpoint our diagnostic capability. So the otherwise you have to depend on laboratory tests like immunohistochemical staining of brain tissue. Just if the animal is dead, you can go for taking sample from the brain tissue, and which will be subjected for immunohistochemical. Then the next important thing is virus isolation in bovine or ovine cell lines. Any of the cell line can be used. So whereby you could be able to isolate the virus either from the whole blood or from the tissue also. So otherwise you can go for ELISA or indirect fluorescent antibody technique. Then serum neutralization titer and PCR, polymerase chain reaction. These are some of the possible ways by which the disease can be easily diagnosed. So whenever you go for producing vaccine or confirmations, that time you may have to isolate the virus. In such circumstances, you should know how the virus, where from the virus will be isolated, which are the substrate which can be normally employed to have a better growth of these viruses. Control and prevention is easy. So first, the identification, removal of the persistently infected animals, and precaution to avoid the introduction of infected animals into a flock. That means, so you have to remove the positive animals, persistently infected animals, and that is prime objective. Then next, you have to take care of your biosecurity procedures. So whenever you procure the animals, then better to, especially the when you procure the animal from the more prevalent areas or even countries, that time you have to screen animal before being introduced into the before being mingled with your whole stock. Then breeding stock should be deliberately mixed with the persistently infected animals at least 2 months before mating, where above policy is not feasible. Generally, it is not possible, but some of the prevalent countries, what people used to do, the breeding stock should be deliberately mixed with persistently infected animals at least 2 months before in view of identification of the problems. Then commercially inactivated adjuvanted vaccine is available for this disease. The commercial vaccine is available whereby the vaccine is being produced with the BDV, body disease virus, and BVD, bovine viral diarrhea virus 1. So either of these two strains can be used for producing vaccines. So BDV used to offer very good production compared to BVD 1. So BVD also used to offer more than 83% protection against the body disease, since they are antigenically related. The next important disease, this is being considered as important, especially in Andhra Pradesh. I think my friend is telling me these kind of problems are being commonly noticed in Andhra Pradesh, especially in Kadapa and Chittoor regions. So this Jaxius, it is a ovine pulmonary adenomatosis or ovine pulmonary carcinoma. It is a significant retrovirus induced disease in sheep in certain regions of the world, so including India. In affected adult sheep, you see the disease leads to chronic wasting and severe respiratory distress. Here you are able to see the chronic wasting and severe respiratory distress. So the virus, the disease is caused by the type B retrovirus, which is being classified as a member of the genus beta retrovirus. The significant progress in understanding of the etiology agent occurred after the virus was cloned, sequenced, and studied in cell culture animal models. We were able to analyze this virus very effectively after subjecting this virus to undergone all these steps like cloning, sequencing, and in cell culture adaptation animal models. Originally, so the disease was described in South Africa, where it was called Jaxius. There is the disease. But then thereafter, the disease occurs worldwide except in Australia and New Zealand, where it has not been documented so far. In Iceland also. But in Iceland, where it was eradicated in 1952. The ovine pulmonary adenomatosis, it occurs sporadically in America as well as in some countries of Europe. So in Peru, the virus may be responsible for perhaps the quarter of the annual mortality in adults. In Peru country, so almost a quarter of the mortality is being reported because of this disease. So epidemiology disease, it was recognized and described by sheep farmers in South Africa. Nearly 800 itself. The word Jaxius is an African term that depicts the clinical outcome of affective cheese, that is cheese means joy and sickness means self, which accurately describe the respiratory disease. So this is an infectious tumor condition resulting from infection with the lenti virus. So this retrovirus, the cause of the disease was identified much later when the virus particles were absorbed lung cells of affected sheep and subsequently confirmed experimentally by reproducing the disease using cell-free lung fluid filtrates and then using molecular clones of Jack-Seed virus in lung gland. So this was the step followed for isolation of the virus. Then the virus infection is naturally transmitted in aerosolized lung fluid. So suppose there is a splashing whenever you do post-mortem of suspected animal, unknown dead animals without knowingly or knowingly. So sometimes if there is a splashing of lung fluid, that time there is a possibility to transmit the pathogens in a natural manner between sheep that are housed in close contact. So following exposure, if you are able to see the clinical disease may be prolonged and generally significant losses occurs in adult sheep that are over 2 years of age, especially after 2 years of age, you can able to expect significant portion of economic loss where return on investment will be affected. So the epidemiology, the incubation period, it varies from 1 year to 3 years, but may be shorter when the young lambs are in control. In case of adult, it will be of around 1 to 3 years, but in the young lambs, it will be shorter, so even months. The outbreak occurs when infected sheep are introduced into an uninfected flock, especially where sheep are confined. So when the sheep are confined, then when you introduce an infected sheep, then there is a possibility to come out with the outbreak form. So the infected animals, usually they shed the virus in saliva, milk, colostrum, and respiratory secretions. And that's the reason the natural infection is presumed to be acquired and maintained principally via the respiratory, that means droplet. So whenever there is a splashing from the lung fluids, it is to produce different respiratory droplets as well as droplet nuclei, and droplets thereby it produce, it transmit the disease through airborne route also. So mainly the animal is to appear the infection pathogens through respiratory route. See, so these are some of the conditions which favors the transmission of the diseases. So when you see the clinical signs, so you will be able to see the pulmonary adenomatosis, which exhibits the progressive dyspnea, anorexia, and cachexia. So whenever there is a pulmonary adenomatosis, you can expect these symptoms, progressive dyspnea, anorexia, and cachexia. So the severely affected animals, it may die of respiratory failure from the massive amount of fluid that is secreted from proliferating type 2 pneumocytes in the neoplastic pocket that are disseminated throughout the lung. As that used to happen because of the COVID nowadays, the cytokine storms of fulfills the lung already, you know, thereby death is happening. The same kind of problem here also. So the animal used to die because of the respiratory failure from massive amount of fluids. So there, the in case of COVID, cytokine storm here. Massive fluid accumulations. So because of the proliferating type 2 pneumocytes in the neoplastic pocket, so causes death. The onset of disease is insidious. The progressive respiratory distress and bouts of spasmodic coughing. So even you can expect bouts of spasmodic coughing and production of large amount of surfactant containing viscous fluids by tumor cells, leading to blockage of small airways and death from anorexia or secondary bacterial pneumonia or otherwise by concurrent ovine lentivirus infection. Sometimes the death may be perpetuated with medivisma infection also. So in affected sheep, so if you're able to see the variably sized neoplastic nodules is scattered through the lungs. And the disease is typically restricted to the lung and metastases are extremely rare. So you may not be able to see the metastatic conditions. Clinical signs again, if you see the increased crackles, you would be able to hear the increased crackle sounds during auscultation over wide area of the chest, especially involved in the ventral portion of the apical and cardiac lobes. So during the advanced stage of the clinical disease, when the tumor morphs may occupy about even up to 50% lung parenchyma cells, means you would be able to see the clearly frothy fluid may flow freely from both nostrils. So you would be able to see the frothy fluid which may flow freely from both the nostrils. And the head is lowered during feeding. And the animal tries to feed by doubling the head, you would be able to see the free frothy fluid coming out from both the nostrils. That is a typical sign of these diseases. And this quantified may exist 50 ml is the hindquarters are rise and the head is, I mean, is lower. Suppose if you lift the animals from the hindquarters by lifting the hindquarters, so you will be able to see the fluid law. That means a froggy fluid coming out around 50 ml of breathing fluid will be coming out through the nostrils. So from the both the nostrils. That condition is colloquially referred as the Wheelbarrow test. When you do this kind of test, when you lift both the hindquarters simultaneously at the same times, so the test is called Wheelbarrow test. This is another test commonly employed to find out the expression of the frothy fluids comes up from the nostrils. This test causes affectation concern sometimes because of the fluid accumulations. It may be uncomfortable for sheep, but this is one of the best diagnostic method to identify the disease. It must be discontinued as soon as some clear fluid appears. And suppose after frothy fluid comes up, if the clear fluid comes, then you have to immediately. So instead of frothy fluid, suppose the clear fluid comes up from the nostrils, then immediately you have to bring the animal to the normal stage. So see, you are able to see the frothy fluid loss in the down photograph. So this is the typical signs of this Leishmaniasis disease. So you read the postmortems, lung will be looking like this. So diagnosis, this virus infection, this Leishmaniasis, it elicits no specific circulatory antibodies against virus. Generally, we can't find any circulatory antibody against virus that can be detected in infected sheep using conventional method. By any of the conventional method, we may not able to detect this antibody against this virus, or this lack of response may be due to immune tolerance caused by the presence of endogenous retroviruses closely related to Leishmaniasis virus. So because of the close presence of other retroviruses which are closely closely related to this virus, it produces immunologic tolerance. So once the animal develops the immunologic tolerance, then it is not able to find antibody production against this virus in the affected animals. Then unique JSRV proviral DNA sequences. You can go for DNA sequences. However, they are detectable with PCR assay of blood leukocytes in clinically affected animal and a percentage of control. What you have to do is just you have to collect the blood. From the blood, you have to go for isolating the leukocytes, lymphocytes. There are so many ready-made solutions available like LymphoProbe, by which you can able to isolate these leukocytes, which can be used for DNA sequences studies. Then improved methods, they also been successfully used to screen the flock for the presence of Leishmaniasis disease, providing a tool for control program in countries with enzootic ovine pulmonary adenomatosis. Then next important thing is animal inoculation and cell culture system. So here, this disease should be differentiated from chronic subacute pneumonia, then pleuropneumonia or pleural abscess. Otherwise, contagious caprine pleuropneumonia, the lung worm infestation, maybe the respiratory abscess caused by CLA, then laryngeal contractis, then enzootic nasal tumors. These are other diseases which are to be differentially diagnosed from this disease. So, with respect to the prevention and control, there are no reports of effective immune responses against ESRV in individual animals, as I told you earlier. So the vaccine against viral infection have not been produced. So that's the reason there is no vaccine produced so far against the disease. So the thing is the depopulation of entire sheep population of country. So if at all you want to have a better control strategy, so you may have to go for stamping out, otherwise the entire depopulation, which may not be possible in country like India. So where we don't have the mechanism of farmers compensation system, so except for catastrophic effect, otherwise disasters. So we don't know the general system of compensatory mechanisms to the farmers when we really want to do the depopulation method. We will employ the depopulation method as a eradication, otherwise control methods. So the incidence of the disease can be reduced greatly by strict isolation of flocks and removal of sick animals. Otherwise, what you can do, the incidence can be reduced just by strict isolation of flocks and removal of sick animals. So immediately upon the onset of clinical signs. Then the antibiotic treatment of secondary bacterial infections. So in case of lung infections, you can think of treating animals with heavy antibiotics. This is the improvement of this. So just it may be of useful to only improve the clinical signs, but this is only a temporary remission and affected sheep must be culled as soon as the disease is confirmed on fumigation. Better to cull the animals rather than going for treatment as they used to produce, as it used to have effect only on temporary basis, temporary effect. So this is about the Jagsales. The next important disease is looping ill. So looping ill, it is a tick-borne viral encephalomyelitis of sheep that also affects red grouse. So occasionally other species, including human being also. So that's the reason it is being classified under brucellosis. The disease is caused by looping ill virus, a member of genus Flavivirus in the family Flaviviridae. So this virus is closely related to other tick-borne flaviviruses, which cause similar disease but demonstrate antigenic as well as geographic variation. Include that means otherwise you can say tropotypes or pathotypes, including Turkish sheep encephalitis virus, Spanish sheep encephalitis virus, and Greek goat encephalitis virus. The looping ill, it occurs in moorland pouches and upland, especially in the United Kingdom, UK, Ireland, and Norway, where the tick vectors, especially Ixodes ricinus, is supported by a ground layer microclimate of high humidity. So this Ixodes ricinus is being considered as the main vector to transmit a pathogen to the susceptible animal. Then Ixodes ricinus, it is a three host tick, as we might have studied in entomology, that becomes infected once it becomes infected with the looping ill virus by feeding on viremic host. This is present mainly in the spring seasons, but also in the early fall season, especially in foreign countries. So when the lambs have lost the colostrum, when the colostrum immunity is getting banned, then the lambs are susceptible to this disease. So it is an acute virus disease of central nervous system, affecting most species of domestic animal as well as man. So although disease primarily associated with the sheep, clinical signs may also occur following infection of cattle, pigs, goats, horses, farm red deer, dogs, as the human as well as a wild red dog. That means this pathogen is having a tendency to get an RFP, otherwise affect multi-species tropism. So there is a high possibility of maintaining the virus in the ecosystem is high because of its natural multi-species tropism. As a disease of sheep, we see, so mainly because of the ataxia and coordination, it has been recognized in upland grazing of Scotland for many years. However, despite numerous investigations, so far, the attribution of causal agents remained elusive until 1930. Nobody could able to come out with the actual proper, the proper diagnostic, that means pathogens or causal agent. When workers in Edinburgh isolated the virus from the brains of affected sheep and thereafter demonstrated its transmission by the sheep tick, that is, Ixodes ricinus, shortly thereafter. So, in the Edinburgh scientists were the people who used to isolate the virus from the brain of the infected sheep. So, after infection of the tick, usually it survives in the salivary glands of the ticks, and infection of new susceptible host occurs when the tick feeds during its next life cycle in the following season. So, although maintained primarily by the sheep tick cycle, it is also amplified by wild type red grouse and hare, so that means wild rabbits, in which high level of viremia sustain the transmission. After tick transmit the pathogen to the sheep, once the pathogen is getting transmitted to sheep through the tick, the replication of LIV, that means looping virus, occurs in lymphatic tissues, in the localized lymphatic tissues, the replication is occurring, followed by viremia develops, then invasion of the CNS after 6 to 20 days. That means the CNSS will be seen only after 6 to 20 days. It depends upon the immunology pressure involved with infected animals. Then viral replication of the CNS results in non-separative inflammation. It generally causes non-separative inflammation, then neuronal degeneration. And so once the neuronal degeneration happens, then the affected animal used to exhibit the associated CNS clinical signs. So this is a member of a diverse group of virus that are transmitted between the vertebrates by Haemophagus arthropods also. It is caused by the flavivirus. So as we discussed earlier, it is readily destroyed by heat, disinfectant, acidic conditions. The capacity of the virus to agglutinate. So as the rabies virus is to get agglutinated by the goose RBCs, here the goose RBCs can be used to do the hemagglutination as well as hemagglutination test. for elimination of antigen as well as the antibody. That's the reason people used to use this HA and HA for elimination of these pathogens by using goose plus goose red blood cells or goose RBCs. The transmission of looping is it is mainly dependent on the sheep tick disorder's resinous as well as the epidemiology infection is intimately linked to the vector. There are two fundamental requirements for the tick. One is moist microbiomatic conditions for its survival, and the tick is not feeding. So when the tick is not feeding, then it needs to have the microclimatic conditions, and the availability of large mammals such as sheep, cattle, hares, deer, on which the adult ticks rely for their blood meats. These two conditions should be fulfilled in view of maintaining the pathogen in the vector population. During 3-year life cycle of the tick, so when we see this, when the vectors during its 3-year life cycle, feeding occurs for only approximately 17 days, the remaining time being spent on the ground, where it is essential that the relative humidity remain close to the saturation. You see, this is the tick which is to spread this.
Speaker sir, can you please move closer to the mic?
Voice is too low, sir. Okay.
Or if you can use headphones, that will be better, sir.
Okay, well, forget it, sir. That's fine. Okay.
Sir, please move close to the mic, sir.
Yeah. Is it okay now? Hello?
Yes.
Yeah, when you see the pathogenesis following subcutaneous injection of the virus by the ticks, then initial replication occurs in the draining lymph node, the nearby draining lymph node. Then thereafter, it is disseminated by this circulation and attaining high titers in blood and lymphatic tissues. So during this viremic phase, there are few clinical signs apart from an elevated rectal temperature. So you're able to see the few clinical signs after 3 to 5 days, the virus can no longer be detected in the blood. So the virus can survive in the blood for a maximum of 3 to 5 days. Thereafter, cannot able to detect the virus in the blood as well as lymphatic tissues. But the virus can persist in the CNS for up to a further 5 days, during which the clinical signs could be observed. So the major clinical signs, if you see sheep, they have acquired protective antibody levels through the previous infection. Suppose if the sheep is having passive immunoglobulins, passive antibody titers, either through the colostrum or from meal or through vaccination or ingestion of colostrum, whatever may be the way, they are usually protected from infection. And clinical signs are most common in lambs older than 3 months of age and yearlings. And thereafter, you will be able to see the clinical signs only in lambs more than 3 months old as well as yearlings. Initially, you will be able to see the pyrexia conditions during the viremic phase. Then anorexia, constipation, and depressions are more observed. Then, and thereby, progression of the disease leads to generalized muscle tremors. Once CNS system is affected, then we will be able to see the muscle tremors and rigidity. Then hyperacesia, as in case of rabies, here also we could able to experience the hyperacesia condition because of the CNS involvement. Then ataxia, hypermetria, and a stiff bounding gait. So severely affected animals, usually they develop cerebral disease and exhibit the head pressing recumbency, convulsion, and coma with progression to death in some cases. All ages of sheep, they appear to be equally susceptible, although in endemic areas, if you see, it is most frequently diagnosed in lambs and yearlings, the two after 3 to 4 months of old. So following infections, 5 to 60% of the animals develop clinical signs, which vary from slight transient ataxia to sudden death. In affected animals, we see the incoordination, progression to paralysis, convulsion, coma, and death within 24 to 48 hours is the general course. In a proportion of non-fatal cases, if you see, the residual torticollis or posterior paralysis may remain for weeks or months. The sequelae can be absorbed even for weeks or months. Fever is not consistently present during the clinical phase of the infections. In the early phase, you will be able to see the pyrexia conditions. When sheep are infected with looping virus, a few days after infection with another tick-borne pathogen, then the anaplasma, phagocytophyllum, the reaction is very much severe. So that means comorbidity. Whereas you will be able to see the reaction in a very severe forms than that of animal affected with either organism alone. So the comorbidity increases the mortality. In addition to the anticipated neurological signs, the dysentery frequently develops, and infection by normal commercial fungus agents may result in extensive pathological changes with mortality even approaching 100%, as this experience with the mucormycosis in case of COVID patient. So this is the condition of animals. Clinically affected animals would be showing symptoms like this in case of looping ill. And this is the diagnosis. So the, when the neurological signs develop, then viremia obviously has ceased. So the virus isolation from blood did not be successful. So what we have to do then, high level of specific antibody develops in CSF of affected animals. So what you have to do, just you have to go for collecting CSF in your aggregation of antibodies. CSF should be handled with caution owing to the zoonotic potential of looping ill virus. So whenever you go for collecting CSF for quantifying the antibody levels, so in view of diagnosis, so you have to be very careful while collecting samples since the virus is considered to be highly zoonotic nature. The detection of hemagglutinin IgM antibodies, which occur in early disease course, maybe is diagnostically also. Then no GRAS lesions are observed on postmortem. When you do the postmortems, you may not be able to find much any macroscopic GRAS lesions, pathology lesions. Otherwise, what you have to do, histopathology changes include you would be able to see the perivascular cuffing of mononuclear cells and presence of neutrophils in meninges, brain, and spinal cord. So, so this neuronal degeneration is the most evident in cerebellar Purkinje cells. When you go for cytology of Purkinje fibers, Purkinje cells taken from the cerebellum, you would be able to see the neuronal degeneration in cytology. Otherwise, the virus isolation, you know, histochemistry or PCR technique are useful to demonstrate the LIV issues. The detection of virus, either by immunohistochemistry, polymerase chain reactions, or isolation of virus. Then the pieces of brain collected in glycerol saline or washed and homogenized for virus isolation cell culture, or the detection of viral RNA by RT-PCR. Virus can be propagated either in mice by intracerebral inoculation, or otherwise in cell cultures, including baby hamster kidney PHA21 cell line, or pig kidney cell line, chick embryo, or sheep kidney cell lines. And serum antibody may be detected 5 to 6 days after infection, which at first are largely on the IgM class. Obviously, the first antibody to come be produced is IgM, and are progressively replaced by the IgG antibody over following 7 to 10 days. Treatment, of course, there is no specific therapy available for this disease, and affected animals should receive supportive care only. Prevention and controls. It may cause a disease in humans since the looping virus causes a disease in humans and veterinarians, shepherd and abattoir workers, they are always at increased risk for infection. So the infection of susceptible sheep may be prevented by vaccination or agaricide treatment. Either you can target the vector control, otherwise developing the immunological pressure in the target population or susceptible population by immunization. By 1934, a vaccine prepared from formalized infected sheep brine had been developed. So initially they developed the inactivated vaccines, and further research was minimal until late 90s. Then thereafter there was sluggish in virus research, especially in this virus. But nowadays, use of both live virus as well as formally inactivated vaccine derived from infected sheep brain or infected mouse brain or chick, sheep or baby hamster cell cultures. So either you can go for cell culture technique, otherwise primary inoculation, that means primary culture, in view of getting both live as well as formally inactivated vaccines. Vaccine presently available is inactivated virus propagated on BHA21 cells, which is the virus where the virus is concentrated with membrane filtration and incorporated in an oil-based adjuvant. So it is administered as a single subcutaneous injection and in the neck region. So the next emerging disease is called Medivisna. So the clinical manifestation of Medivisna, it varies considerably between countries. In USA, the infection is more commonly referred as ovine progress pneumonia when affecting lungs, or heart back when affecting the mammary gland. Such pathology rarely identified in the UK, where Medivisna are more common clinical presentation of MV infections. But here, this infection with Medivisna virus may cause lymphocytic mastitis. The lymphocytic mastitis is called heart back, as well as joint. Then brain, Visna means when the brain is affected, it is called Visna, or when the lung is infected, that time it will be called as Medi. Etiology, the Medivisna is a sheep, the sheep is characterized by respiratory, that is especially interstitial pneumonia, the nervous forms, progressive inflammatory disease of central nervous system. The clinical signs, you see the occasionally the joints as well as mastitis. So it is coming to retrovirulent family antivirus. So this SRLV currently classified according to the phylogenetic relationship into five groups, that is A, B, C, D, and E. Genotype A includes strains of Medivisna virus. Genotype B, Caprin arthritis encephalitis virus. Genotype C corresponds to SRLV isolated Marburgian sheep and goats. Then genotype B has been identified in analyzing whole sequence of SRLV as a Spanish. That is genotype E has been isolated recently in Italy. So this is the structure of this virus, Medivisna. And you see the transmission dynamics. The route of transmission is related to body fluids, mainly respiratory exudates, milk or colostrum, which may contain infected monocytes as well as macrophages. The main transmission route is airborne, powered by overcrowding and milk-borne. It is not clear the transmission among the animals occurs through the process of free variants and or through the infected cells. Clinical presentation we see, so the report described enterative mastitis without changes in the milk. The udder is smaller and more fibrous than normal, but this proves difficult to detect in lactating ewes and is better appreciated during pre-breeding check before 2 to 3 months after weaning. The shepherd is alerted to this ewes by unexplained poor growth rate of the lambs. So when you see the respiratory forms, the respiratory disease, so it is most common clinical forms in sheep. It affects adult animals older than 2 years, and once the symptoms are apparent, animal life expectancy does not exceed 1 year. Animal may not live more than 1 year. So the exercise intolerance is one of the first clinical signs to be noticed, followed by dyspnea at rest, accompanied by abdominal breathing, neck extension, expansion of nostrils, and breathing with mouth open. These are all pathognomonic clinical signs associated with the respiratory form of this disease. As the disease progresses, the animal suffers from anorexia, weight loss, and finally cachexia. Nasal exudate appears only when there are secondary bacterial infections. The clinical signs are caused by the interstitial pneumonia that increases the thickness of the alveolar septa. So generally, it increases the thickness of alveolar septa, thereby they reduce the space availability of alveoli and progressively reduces the air exchange capacity of the affected lungs. Whereas if you see the mammary disease, it is the second important form due to economic losses and frequency of occurrences. So in some breeds, especially Rasa Aragonia from Spain, it may be more frequent than respiratory forms. Generally affects adult animals aged between 3 and 5 years. But it has also been observed in 1 year old also. The milk production can be decreased. Obviously, when there is a mastitis, then milk is reduced. And its macroscopic properties like color consistency may not be varying. So it will be as such. Whereas you see the joint disease, arthritis is the least common presentation in Medivisna, but frequently to be noticed only canine arthritis and encephalitis. It affects the animals aged between 2 and 3 years. It usually affects the corbel as well as torsional joints. So process is marked by lameness. The process starts with edema and congestion of the synovial membrane and capsule of the joint, which causes both structures to thicken as well as enlarge the joints. There is hardening of the periarticular tissue and synovial membrane proliferation, along with the frequent erosion of the articular surfaces, which may even extend to the bone destruction also. So whereas in case of nervous forms, the nervous form is very rare in sheep, where it is mostly seen in stabled animals. It affects animals aged more than 2 years old, although in some breeds such as Asaf, it may occur in younger animals also. The nervous signs include, when you see the major clinical signs in nervous form, hind limb weakness and ataxia, hypermetria and paralysis, usually leading to recumbence, although the animal remains alert and responds to even external stimuli. The main lesion is encephalitis or encephalomyelitis. So then chronic non-purulent meningeal encephalitis, usually accompanied by demyelination, is a common form in nervous diseases. So when you see the Visna clinical manifestations, the incubation period is protracted. So generally the clinical disease is more common in 4 to 5 years old sheep. There are essentially two forms of Visna. One is brain form and a spinal cord form. In each form, the neurological signs are insidious in onset. It will be quick in onset with a gradual deterioration over a period of months. The brain forms, the neurological signs are insidious in onset again. It presents a head tilt of approximately 5 to 10 degrees from the vertical plant and settling towards the affected side. The clinical signs result from lesions within the lateral ventricles. You will be able to see the lesions in the lateral ventricles. Some affected sheep may display hypermetria as well as hind limb ataxia. There is a slow deterioration of the neurological signs, and affected sheep are usually destroyed by human reasons within 2 months of initial recognition of the conditions, especially happening in overseas countries. Spinal forms. So the initial neurological signs are hypometria, reduced flexion of the hind limb joints, the reduced weight bearing affecting one hind limb, and conscious proprioceptive deficits. As the condition progresses, you will be able to see the dorsal surface, the hooves remain in contact with the ground, and the limb is weight bearing. There is characteristics knuckling of pedlec joint. So, and finally, hind limb paralysis. Knuckling of pedlec joint and hind limb paralysis are being considered as major pathognomonic symptoms of spinal forms. So, see, you will be able to see these symptoms like this in case of affected animals. So, when you see the differential analysis, the brain form should be differentiated from peripheral vestibular lesions, scrappy, or some of the spaced walkway brain lesions such as abscess formation or sclerosis. Whereas spinal cord form should be differentially diagnosed from vertebral empyema, hind limb joint lesions, peroneal nerve paralysis, or sarcosystosis. The next important is scrapie. So it is the earliest known member of the transmissible spongiform encephalopathy and is characterized by uniformly fatal or progressive neurodegenerative disease of sheep and less frequently being noticed in goats. So disease is classified as classical scrapie or atypical scrapie according to immunobiochemical differences and variation in the localization of neuropathological lesions. Both classical as well as atypical form of scrapie have been reported in sheep and goats. Scrapie is endemic in most countries but appears to have been eliminated from Australia and New Zealand by extensive slaughter campaigns. And you see the epidemiology, it is a chronic, progressive, invariably fatal neurodegenerative disorder naturally affecting sheep and goats, as the BSE used to happen in bovines. The scrapie belongs to a group of disorders commonly referred to as a prion protein disorders or prion diseases, or that is called transmissible spongiform encephalopathy group. The causative agent of scrapie is believed to be transmissible self-replicating protein that lacks nucleic acid, that is called prions, otherwise proteinaceous infectious particle. However, other hypothesis agents we see, including bacterial small media, may be involved in pathobiology of BSEs and production of the characteristics abnormal protein found in affected animals. The infectious agent is highly resistant to many methods of disinfections and can be recovered from even fresh frozen as well as formaldehyde fixed tissues. The accumulation of PRBSE in nervous tissues is associated with the development of clinical signs. Once clinical signs develops, then only we can able to isolate these free proteins from the nervous tissues. Species tropism, sheep and goats are the primary host. Young sheep appears to be most susceptible to infection. Susceptibility and length of incubation time is strongly associated with polymorphism of prion protein G. In sheep, the polymorphisms at codon 136, 154, and 171 is being designated as A136B bar T, R154H bar L, and Q171R bar H and K respectively. So these codons are linked to susceptibility or resistant to classical scrapie. This ARR genotype is most resistant to scrapie and therefore recommended for breeding. The highest risk for classical scrapie is found in sheep with the genotype VRQ bar VRQ, VRQ bar ARQ, VRQ bar ARH, and VRQ by AHQ. So these when you find these genes, so then you can consider that those breeds or those animals are under high risk. The increased susceptibility of Suffolk sheep is associated with homozygosity for glutamine at codon 171. So the genotype ARR or AR does not protect from atypical scrapie, in which the polymorphism of codon 141 and 144 are important for disease susceptibility. So in case of goats, the susceptibility scrapie also associated with PRP gene polymorphism. However, these are only incompletely, so this system is incompletely understood. The codons 142, 154, 211, 222 appear to be influential for classical scrapie in case of goats. Codon 154 also was related to atypical caprine scrapie. So transient dynamics, so mainly the agent is not fully understood in the transient dynamics of these agents is not fully understood. However, the infected animals contaminate the poison by shedding from the placenta and fetal fluids, and possibly by other routes, but mainly through placenta and fetal fluids. The shedding of pathogens occurs during the extended incubation period. The transmission is likely to occur only by the horizontal mode of transition of the organisms. So, this is the pathogenesis. After once the pre-protein is ingested, the agent crosses the intestinal mucosa and inverts the gut-associated lymphoid tissues, where it replicates before invasion of the nervous system. Then the agent reaches the CNS by way of enteric nervous system, followed by sympathetic and parasympathetic fibers. The initial infection of the brain is localized to the diencephalon and medulla oblongata regions, with the subsequent replication in other areas of the brain. Non-inflammatory, otherwise the vascular degeneration of the gray matter, the presence of PRPS in scrapie-associated fibrils follows and finally results in production of clinical signs. The clinical signs mainly produces the progressive and protracted neurological as well as dermatological diseases, character of intense wasting, pruritus, behavioral changes, and gait abnormalities. The clinical course may last for even 2 to 12 months, but in sheep is commonly approximately observed for 6 months and goes between 2 to 24 weeks. Since the affected animals usually are between 2 and 5 years of age, but sometimes even may be older, but initial clinical signs are subtle and noticed intermittently. The behavior changes, such as aggression towards the people and objects, and fixed gaze, charging dogs or gates, and failure to respond to herding or some of the obvious clinical signs noted. The affected animals begin rubbing and biting. So the animal starts rubbing and biting, especially the tail head, rump and thigh region, and dorsum, as well as ataxia and weight loss become apparent. As clinical signs worsens, you would see the pruritus becomes more persistent and leads to wool loss and self-implicated trauma, which may manifest as oral hematomas or facial swelling with secondary bacterial infection in some instances. Application of pressure to affected areas may provoke a scratch reflex, during which the animal wriggles on the distal extremities, smacks and licks its lips, and performs rhythmic head movements. Gait abnormalities begins as high limb ataxia and are progressive. The poor postural reactions, exaggerated gaits, hypermetria, bunny hopping and falling can be observed. The affected animals also separate from the herd and become severely anorectic, which may predispose the females to even pregnancy toxemia. The other clinical signs may include nystagmus, inability to swallow, these are the pharyngeal paralysis, dysphonia, blindness, and vomiting. And severely affected animals are emaciated, weak, and become recumbent with convulsions and hyperextension of the limbs. So affected animals, so because of the scrapie, sometimes you are able to see the alopecia conditions. These are the pruritus, selfish, pre-loss. So it will, the signs will be looking like this. So diagnosis, so it is a notifying, otherwise a reportable disease. The early contact with the regulatory authorities limit the potential for misdiagnosis and errors in the enforcement of control and eradication strategies. The antimicrobial diagnostic test for scrapie rely on the detection of the free protein PRPS in lymphoid tissues. Otherwise, you can go for immunohistochemical techniques on biopsy specimen from tonsils, pharyngeal lymph nodes, or lymphoid follicles. The detection of PRPS proteins or plaques in lymphoid tissues enables the identification of preclinical disease before involvement of the nervous system. Otherwise, you can go for tonsillary biopsy material. It is a better sample for analysis, but it is difficult to collect. Otherwise, it is being considered as a better sample. And third eyelid specimens are easier to obtain, but may not contain sufficient amount of lymphoid tissue, especially the early stages. So when PRPS is less evidently distributed. Less evenly distributed. So otherwise, you can go for postmortem diagnosis. It is mainly based on the histopathological identification of the degenerative changes in the CNS gray matter. So which could be easily identified by histopathology or cytology. Then identification of PRPS is performed by immunohistochemistry. Western blot, ELISA are confirmation dependent immunoassay. So mostly people used to go for immunohistochemistry as well as ELISA. Treatment, there is no effective treatment available. Then early diagnosis, the removal of affected animals are paramount in preventing the disease transmission and should be undertaken in collaboration with the regulatory authorities. Prevention control. So this crappy prevention is mainly based on the removal of affected and high risk animal from the herd, biosecurity, selective breeding for resistant animals, especially preferring the ALR genotype. When affected small ruminants are identified, the regulatory authorities may require removal and testing of the entire flock or of affected and high risk animals. So especially the sheep born in the same year as those affected, offspring of the affected sheep, lambs born in the year affected gave birth. The voluntary scrapie flocks at Mission Ground, which is commonly available in prevalent countries, that means Western and wherever especially in developed countries. The natural breeding efforts to perpetuate the resistant genotype and increase testing strategies are used in scrapie eradication effort. Although genetic selection for resistance is utilized for the prevention of classical scrapie in sheep, the breeding for resistance against atypical scrapie and scrapie resistant goats still proves challenging. Still, so much research is going on. So far we have discussed about some of the important emerging diseases of small ruminants. Coming to the neonatal disease, so there are in small ruminant practices, the loss due to neonatal death is posing threats. So especially the perinatal lamb mortality occurring in the flock hampers the growth, otherwise the productivity is getting reduced because of the perinatal lamb mortality. So whenever you see, when the mortality is less than 5% in any flock, that can be considered. So it may be considered good, but if it goes beyond 7% mortality, then definitely it is action taken. It is alarming to take some actions. So the farm management affects generally the management practices. The farm management practices is affect the perinatal mortality, lamb birth weight together with the ewe body condition score, and the colostrum accumulation in the udder at lamping remain the fundamental to ensuring a good start for the lamb during the critical first 36 hours of life. So especially when you see the neonatal mortality, so there are so many problems. So especially the accumulation of thing, mismothering, maternal instinct, there are so many kind of multiple birth, so the lack of colostrum feeding, all these other management factors is to pose a threat. So these conditions, otherwise you can say the weakly lambs conditions. So due to the infectious diseases, like there are many causes of weakly lambs at birth, including infectious diseases of abortion like toxoplasmosis, border disease, chlamydophila abortus, salmonella serotype, salmonellosis, campylobacter fetus, intestinalis, listeria monocytogenes, and pasteurella. So these pathogens also cause producing weak lambs. The lack of colostrum, generally the lack of colostrum accumulation within the udder can arise from the poor dam nutrition during late pregnancy. Suppose if there is any malnutrition to the dam during the late pregnancy, then obviously there is a lack of colostrum production. Then if there is any mastitis conditions, obviously, the milk will be reduced. That way, the colostrum availability of colostrum will be of less to the offsprings. Then, chronic debilitating disease, this is Zoni disease. So, they also reduce the colostrum production. The Mary Vicina virus, since it produces immunity mastitis, it also reduces the colostrum production as well as otherwise pose a threat to have a lack of colostrum to the newsprings. The important neonatal diseases in small ruminant practices we see mainly watery mouth disease, the enteritis mainly E. coli and salmonellosis, then hemorrhagic enteritis, so as it is possible the clostridial diseases. So in case of lambs, it is to produce hemorrhagic enteritis, whereas in adult under more than 6 months, you can expect the strep, the major conditions like homeoglobinitis, then starvation and exposure death. These are some of the conditions which used to pose a threat for neonatal mortality in case of small ruminant practices. So when you see the watery mouth disease, so it is a colloquial expression actually is to describe the collection of clinical signs in neonatal lambs. So they used to found different kinds of collection of diseases in neonatal lambs, especially in operating conditions. So that's the reason they used to give this name as a watery mouth disease, as a colloquial name. It includes lethargy, then unwillingness to search for the teeth. So and such. So usually when you see the lambs, so immediately after birth, so the suck reflex will be high during within 1 hour of its birth. So during first hours of birth, first 1 hour, you will be able to see the high suck reflex. So that is the reason immediately after birth, the colostrum feeding should be given. So obviously the colostrum will be seen for lambs at least 200 ml per kg is required colostrum feeding. But within 3 hours, at least you have to offer 50 ml per kg body weight. Okay, within 3 hours of its birth. So then at least this colostrum should be considered between or up to 24 to even 36 hours of birth. So when there is a lack of colostrum, then they are prone for these kind of diseases. They used to show the lethargy, unwillingness to suck for the teeth and such, profuse salivation, increasing abdominal distension, and retained meconium. These are all some of the collective clinical signs where they are being named as watery mouth disease. This condition is caused by the colonization of small intestine by Escherichia coli as with the rapid multiplication followed by a cell death and release of lipopolysaccharides. The normal mean hematocrit value of the C, so you can able to see the increased hematocrit values, high lactate and urea concentration, leukopenia, hypoglycemia, naturally occurring watery mouth disease, various field studies or which are showing the consistent results. So the watery mouth disease, the lambs will be showing the symptoms like this. So due to the postmortem, you will be able to see the flakes or milk and milk casein. So in the intestine. So this diagnosis of disease, so you could able to diagnose this watery mouth disease by low plasma glucose concentration, leukopenia conditions, and elevated bun, endotoxemia, and when you do the postmortem, you could able to see the agonal septicemia. So treatment, so here you can consider mild laxative or purgative, which promote the gut activity and expulsion of meconium. Otherwise, the oral antibiotics are effective during early phase of the disease. Especially an aminoglycosides such as pectinomycin. This is probably the drug of choice because it maintains high concentration within the gut lumen. Otherwise, again, you have to support the oral electrolyte therapy at a rate of 50 ml kg body weight QAD is essential. Control, so you can go for abundant clean, dry straw bedding, offering out of dry straw bedding, and cleanliness should be proper. The use of paraformaldehyde powder on straw bedding. Then cleaning and disinfection of individual pans between lamping use. These are some of the strategies commonly followed in view of controlling the disease. So there is enteritis. So this is caused by the enterotoxinic strain of E. coli. So there are 6 serogroups in E. coli. So the most pathogenic device is the enterotoxinic E. coli ETEC group is causing the enteritis. Though it is being considered as uncommon, but relatively it is being reported. The outbreak of neonatal diarrhea in lambs caused by the enterotoxinic E. coli such as K99 or F41 serotype are uncommon but may affect lambs less than 4 days old. There is a rapid spread of the disease in situation where lambs are crowded. When there is increased stock density of the lambs, then there is a chance to develop this enteritis. ETEC enteritis affects the lambs less than 4 days old within a high morbidity rate. The clinical signs include profuse yellow diarrhea with obvious staining of the tail. So you could able to see the yellow diarrhea with the obvious staining of the tail and perineum, rapid dehydration because of the diarrhea, then weakness and death within 24 hours of onset of clinical signs. So most of the time people neglect these kind of symptoms. So they don't go for treating the animals at early stage. So diagnosis obviously based on the clinical signs, otherwise you can go for collecting the samples, fecal culture and serotyping. So, serotyping of K99 or F41 febrile antigens. Isolation to avoid high morbidity rate. Then oral electrolyte therapy at the rate of 50 ml per kg, 4 times a day. Then oral antibiotics like pectinomycin. Generally, the flocks with the history of ETEC should be vaccinated. There are vaccines available by using K99 and febrile antigen F41. You should be vaccinated 8 and 4 weeks prior to the expected lambing date with the multivalent vaccines containing these serotypes. So when you see this enteritis due to salmonella, so these serotypes are only a problem in young lambs. there is an obvious source of infection, either from an existing abortion problem in the ewes or infection gained from the cattle or poison contamination by a sewage effluent. So this pathogen like Salmonella typhimurium can cause abortion in ewes, leading to further developmental contamination. And then Salmonella typhimurium and doubling. So this typhimurium doubling infection can be acquired from cattle by direct contact with the either aborted material or feces, with the development of severe clinical signs. The Salmonella typhimurium, other serotypes can be contacted from sewage effluents. So here you could able to see the sudden death without preliminary signs to healthy carrier sheep. The clinical signs are most severe in lambs less than 1 week old. In young lambs, there is a rapid onset of dysentery, rapid dehydration, toxemia, gonadal septicemia, and death. So the affected lambs appear gaunt and show signs of abdominal pain with frequent tenesmus. So diagnosis, the confirmation again bacterial isolation from the fecal sample and visceral septicemic cases. We can go for culture and isolation. So the next important thing is omboflebitis. So omboflebitis conditions is a common in young lamb born to unsanitary conditions where there is a inadequate level treatment. So you would be able to see the omboflebitis like this. So when there are so many pathogens starting from polyarthritis, causing streptococcus, dysgalaxia, and Physoporum, Necroporum. So like this, there are several pathogens which used to produce these conditions. So sometimes, as an extension of this omboflebitis, it may extend to the necrotic peritonitis. So when it produces hepatic peritonitis or otherwise necrotic peritonitis, so then the treatment, otherwise the prognosis will be of godhead. So even if you try to treat the animals, it may not be of much value. So you have to obviously lose the lambs or kids. So this omboflebitis is more commonly observed conditions because of the mismanagement, particularly improper management. So when they don't clean the, or when they don't cut the umbilical properly and disinfected with bovidin-iodine or any antibiotic ointments, then they may have to get it infected with the environmental pathogens, contaminated environment, thereby the omboflebitis results. Then sometimes it may get extended to the peritonitis also. Once peritonitis and peritonitis produced, obviously the growth, that means the effect of treatment is of no value. Then we have to mainly lose the neonatal, that means lambs and kids. So with this small informations, I wanted to close today. So since took long time, I think I can able to restrict this information for today's webinar.